Let's all be standing, if you will. Take an opportunity to shake hands, fellowship with one another. Let someone know that you're glad to see them this morning as we worship.
This goes out to every outcast, to the just don't quite fit in. Every long way, run away, rebel, so we should have to wear. This goes out to every searcher, trying to fill that empty space. Well, your searching days are over now, everything's about to change.
Stretched out his arms on a rugged cross and painted the sea.
thy sweet forgiveness on. Come join the Jesus people. This is where your heart is.
Keeping Jesus at a distance, so afraid to let him get too close to the two lives I've been living, as if he couldn't see them both. Close enough to feel the warmth of the fire, far enough away for me to hide. But I'm tired of walking the wire between the darkness and the light. And no more Jesus at a distance, no more pushing you. And I don't want to settle for the back road of some Sunday morning thing. So I'm holding nothing back now, cause there's nothing you don't see. No more Jesus at a distance. Come change every part of me, every part of me. I was offered resurrection, but I settled for the grave. Had the chance to walk on water, but I chose to play it safe. I've been hiding from the healer, I thought my wounds were out of reach. But at the end of all my running, you're still running out of reach. And no more Jesus at a distance, no more pushing you away, cause I don't want to settle. So I'm holding nothing back now, cause there's nothing you don't see. No more Jesus at a distance. Come change every part of me, every part of me. Every part of me. All my dreams and all my treasures.
Every part of me. Every part of me.
I can barely hold it together.
Everybody, everybody.
When I can't control what tomorrow's gonna bring.
Everybody.
When the ghost of my yesterday comes calling.
Everybody.
Who I am when there's no one else around.
Everybody.
When the sun comes up. No more pushing you away. I don't want to settle for the back road of some Sunday morning affair. So I'm holding nothing back now, cause there's nothing you don't see. No more Jesus at a distance. Come change every part of me, every part of me, every part. There's nothing you don't see. No more Jesus at a distance. Come change every part of me. No more Jesus at a distance. Come change every part of me.
From heaven's throne.
Pastor comes, let's bow our heads for a word of prayer. Father, we are so grateful to you for sending your son to take our place, Father, and pay the debt, God, that we just do not have the ability to pay. But Father, you chose to do that out of love, and we thank you for that this morning. We praise you for that, and Father, we praise you and thank you for your grace and for your mercy that you give to us daily. Father, we thank you for all that you have done in the service this morning already, and as we turn our attention to the preaching of your word, Father, we pray that you would be with Pastor this morning, that you would use the words that you have given him to challenge us and to draw us closer to you. Father, we ask these things in your name. Amen.
Amen. So if you have your Bibles this morning, we're going to be in Ephesians chapter 2. And the reason we believe the cross was enough is because when Jesus shed his blood on Calvary and when he willingly gave up his body to be broken, he did everything that was necessary to satisfy the demand of God for justice. And in doing so, he provided a way in which we could be forgiven apart from anything else other than the cross of Jesus. That gift on Calvary brought about our salvation, and it was not because of what we do or what we did or what we're going to do or what we can't do. Salvation is essentially God's gift to us through Jesus Christ when we believe in him for the forgiveness of sins. Isn't that so easy? It's so simple, and yet, do you know how hard we've made it in American day to be a Christian? By introducing all this other stuff that is really not necessary for salvation. So we're going to talk a little bit about that, in particular, understanding the importance of the body and the blood of Jesus. As you can see, we're set up for communion this morning, so that's going to be a part of what we do. So I got to watch the clock, really. I mean, I hate to say this, I got like a full-blown sermon going on in here, but somehow I got to work communion in that as well, so I'm not sure how that all shakes out, but we'll see what we do. So I want to start with this. We watched The Chosen, like, going up into and around Easter, and so we kind of recapped everything from seasons 1, 2, and 3. One of the things that just irritated me, normally I watch it and I cry, I would actually move from like tears to irritation. And here's one of the things that irritated me about the show. This is the only thing. It was the way the Pharisees interacted with the people. And I don't know if you picked up on that. It really stood out to me this time. So one of the things that just frustrated me is that when you watch The Chosen, one of the things you see is that when the Pharisees are walking down through the marketplace, you know what everybody does as they get closer? They move out of their way. Now see, I don't know if it's just my rebellious American spirit. I would want to stand in their way just to irritate them. Mitch kind of like that too. I would just want to be in their way. Oh, sorry, I didn't know you were there. Just to be a pain maybe. And it frustrated me to watch how people would be in their way and when they realized that they would like bow their heads to them and back away. Now again, I don't know if it's because I'm an American and I have a naturally rebellious spirit that tells me I don't bow down to anyone. That makes me look at it and think that just disgusts me. But here's what I know from the New Testament. That's the kind of stuff they love. Do you realize that? That's what they love. They love to be in the marketplace and hear someone say, Rabbi. Or they love to be in the marketplace and they love to watch the people move away as they walk down the street. Now, I'll just tell you as a guy who's a little bit introverted, I don't like crowds. I would love it if when I walked in a crowded place, everybody would move aside. I do. I'm just telling you. I remember we went to New York years ago, New York City. And I remember being in New York City for the first time. Look, I'm born and raised in Pike County. And I've been in big cities before. I've been to Chicago, and I've been to Orlando, if you call that a big city. And I remember we went to Times Square, and I have never seen so many people in one place in my entire life. We were pressed in shoulder to shoulder. No one made eye contact. And I remember thinking two things. Number one is, this would be an amazing place to set off a bomb right now. Okay, not for me, but I mean for someone who's going to commit an act of terrorism. That's what I thought. And I'm immediately looking everywhere for how do I escape, because that's the way my brain works. The second thing I thought is, how in the world can I get out of here right now? I want to be here. And I would have loved it if I was in Times Square and the crowds parted as I walked through, just because that's me personally being comfortable with it. That's not why the crowds parted when the rabbis and the Pharisees walked by. They parted because the people really believed that they were entitled to some show of respect because of the clothes they wore. Isn't that just ridiculous? Just ridiculous, and that's what's going on. So let me read some scripture this morning and kind of start off there. I'm going to read in verse 11 of Ephesians chapter 2, and this is what Paul says, and I get this as a Gentile, just for the record. Therefore, remember that you, once Gentiles in the flesh, who are called uncircumcision by what is called the circumcision, made in the flesh by hands, that at that time you were without Christ, being alienated from the commonwealth of Israel, strangers from the covenant of promise, having no hope and without God in the world. But now in Christ Jesus, you who were once afar off have been brought near by the blood of Christ. For he himself is our peace, who has made both one and has broken down the middle wall of separation, having abolished in his flesh. Now there are some things in here I want you to pay attention to. And in particular, it's this word flesh that is going to be used about three times in here. So we're talking about an act of the flesh, and then we're going to be talking about the sacrifice of flesh, which both may be true in this case. I don't know. That he might reconcile them both to God and one body through the cross, thereby putting death to the enmity. And he came and preached peace to you who were afar off and those who are near. For through him, we both have access to the Father. Bow your heads with me this morning. Father, we are thankful to be together again today. Thankful for your son, Jesus Christ. And I don't know that I could ever say enough. I want to thank you for what you did for me. And not just for me, but for everyone who's here today. In sending your son, Jesus, into the world. You paid the price for our sin. And it doesn't matter how good we would have lived. It doesn't matter what we would have done right. We would have never been able to live good enough to please you and to satisfy the requirements that were needed for our sin. But because of your mercy, no other reason, because of your grace and your mercy, when you looked on a guy like me, and not just me, but everybody else, when you looked on me, you didn't react in anger or frustration. You reacted in love, and you sent your son Jesus into the world to pay for our sins. And we are thankful for that, Father, that you were willing to do for us what we could not do for ourselves. And so this morning, as we get into your word, I want you to open our hearts, help us understand this morning how we, even though we want to live righteous lives, we want to live holy lives, we want to be close to you, there are times when we all drift away. There are times when we all fall into things we shouldn't. Help us remember that there is grace and there is mercy. Not because of what we do, but because of what you've done for us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. I'm already getting emotional. We haven't got the communion yet. And so, you know, one of the things I learned about Lexi, let me just say this. Y'all know Lexi's a nurse. And I remember when Lexi decided she wanted to be a nurse, which I think was about 2 or 3 years old. I mean, she's wanted to be a nurse for as long as I can remember. Is that right? And so I remember when Lexi got older and she realized, yeah, I'm going to be a nurse. I'm going to go to college. And I remember, you know, helping her study and look at her curriculum. And I remember saying, I couldn't do that. I could not be a nurse. Not because I can't handle blood. I'll just be honest with you. I can't pronounce about a third of the terminology that's involved in nursing. Okay? I just can't pronounce it. And I'd be trying to help Lexi study and she's correcting me because I pronounce a word wrong. Not only that, I just couldn't remember the mountain of information that she had to remember to be a nurse. And we got some other nurses in here. I'm just saying, I don't know how you did it, because that was it was a grueling curriculum. So I'm very obviously I'm proud of Lexi because she is a nurse, because of what she did. I'm just saying, as a dad, I was particularly proud to hear the other day that she apparently has a nursing skill that is like off the charts. And so when I hear that, I'm like, ooh, tell me more. I mean, you're the kind of nurse that other people are calling because this skill is so, you're so good at it that other people are calling you to say, hey, can you come and do this for me? And I'm thinking it's like, I don't know, it's life-saving, CPR, right? Something like that. Her advanced skill, she's putting in a catheter. Yeah, Phil, that's exactly the face that I made when she said that. Ow. Putting in a catheter. So my daughter's great skill in nursing is something I don't even want to talk about, let alone think about, because it's weird. So last night, Lexi, that's when I found out, that was last night. Lexi's telling me about what her great skills are and how other people call and say, hey, can you put this catheter in? What I'm thinking in the back of my mind is, no one else wants to do it and you're willing. That's the difference. And so what I thought is, because look, I'm comfortable talking with my kids about stuff like this, especially if I think there's an opportunity that I can embarrass Landon by it, I'm going to take full advantage of that. I'm like, Lexi, hey, give me some details about how this process works. And she said, like, I'm not gonna, so she started like, hey, you know what? You know what? I just want to stop this conversation right now. Don't want to go any farther, okay? Oh, I know. So I'm saying that because this section deals with something that personally I find uncomfortable to talk about. And so let me read verse 11 again to kind of set the stage for everything that follows. Therefore, remember that you, once Gentiles in the flesh, okay, so we're talking about the body here. You, once Gentiles in the flesh, who are called what? Uncircumcision by the circumcision, okay? So this whole section is about, or this whole context is about the idea of circumcision. That is uncomfortable for me to think about and talk about in a public setting. But everybody understands what it is, right? So I always say this. Sometimes we get into uncomfortable topics, and if you need more explanation or you need help understanding what circumcision is, we have an elder at this church whose primary job is to educate on those uncomfortable topics, and his name is Phil. So if you want more information about how this process worked, see Phil, and he's going to help you out. Because this is what we know about the Jewish faith, okay? If you were to say, or if you would ask somebody, hey, what makes Jewish people different than Gentiles? Most people in our day and age would probably say it was the law. They followed the law and they lived by the law. And so we think in particular about the way the Pharisees lived their lives and the way they worked. So the Pharisees would walk around in these special robes, and Jesus said to them, they would make broad their phylacteries. If you don't know what a phylactery is, I can explain that to you. It's a box that you wore on your forehead or on your arms. So these Jewish leaders would put scripture in these boxes. Now, how weird is that, right? I mean, think about it. You're walking around with a box on your forehead or on your arms. Do you know how uncomfortable it would be to go about your day working? Oh, never mind. They didn't work, okay? But you know how uncomfortable it would be for the rest of us to go about our work day? Danny, at the end of the day, is the last thing you want to see is another box? I'm kind of thinking, Danny's not into the put boxes on my head and hands concept, okay? But that's what they did, and they put these boxes on their head, and I'm guessing Jesus said they made broad their phylacteries. So they got these big boxes. I mean, imagine, look, you're walking around with this on your forehead, okay? You know how weird that would be? How weird does this look? How weird is this going to look on video? So when you do the shot for the sermon, this should be the one you use in the app. It's right here. So they're walking around with boxes on their head and on their wrist. And I just got to say, if no one else will, you look a little silly, okay? And they would put long tassels on their garment. That's actually the other thing. In The Chosen, there's this scene where this dude named Shmuel, who I don't like at all, he's got this other Pharisee who comes to see him. And apparently this Pharisee's a little too Greek for his particular tastes because he didn't have any tassels. And so Shmuel kept interrupting what he was saying to ask about his tassels. And that's the world that they lived in. So in Jewish culture, for the people of Jesus' day, they believed that their salvation was affected by the clothes they wore, the people they hung out with, and the things that they did. That's not true. I only understand that today. That's not what brings about salvation in your life. It's not what you wear and who you hang out with. Jesus did everything necessary to bring about salvation for you. This other stuff makes no sense. So a lot of us, when we think about the difference between Jews and Gentiles, we would tend to think more, well, they don't eat pork, okay? So they've got all these law, these Jewish regulations that are part of the law. That's what makes them different than us. That's really not true, okay? So understand, yeah, they follow some laws that are a little weird, at least by my taste, but that's not what makes them the people of God. That's what the Jews in Jesus' day did not understand. They believed that they were the people of God because they observed the Sabbath very strictly, okay? But get this, they observed the Sabbath very strictly unless it conflicted with their custom or their tradition. And Jesus even points that out. So Jesus heals a guy on the Sabbath day. They're at the Pool of Bethesda. It's a Sabbath day. Apparently, doing good deeds on the Sabbath day is something God is displeased with, just for the record, okay? So Jesus sees a lame man, and he heals him. And the Pharisees come to Jesus and say, what? Because he carried his pallet or his bed. Like, why'd you do this on the Sabbath day? Why are you healed on the Sabbath? And Jesus says, look, you Pharisees, you don't care. I'm paraphrasing. You don't care about the Sabbath, okay? So I heal on the Sabbath, and you're mad at me. But in your tradition, if a boy needs to be circumcised on the eighth day, you break the Sabbath to keep your tradition. That's what they did. They broke the law. Pharisees apparently were good at breaking the law when it suited them and fulfilling it when it was hard for everybody else. I'm going to be honest with you. I look at American church culture today, and I see some of that in our church culture where we've created laws and regulations that everybody else has got to follow. We don't do great at it, but everybody else should. That's not what our faith is about. Our faith is not about what you do to please God. Our faith is about God taking the initiative to come to where you are, to lift you out of your sin and say, go and sin no more, lest the worst thing happen to you. That's what Jesus came to do. So Paul, in trying to explain that to these Gentiles, because FYI, the Ephesians are Gentiles. This is a predominantly Gentile church, and they know that. And now here's the other thing about being a Gentile. And so Paul talks about their condition, or their situation. This is not condition, situation. So he says, you're called uncircumcision by what is called the circumcision, made in the flesh by hand. So that refers to the physical act of circumcision. Now, I will give you a little recap, because I want to read some scripture to understand where we're going with this. So circumcision was the original covenant. Did you know that? So the law was not the original covenant that God made with Abraham, okay? So when you go back to Genesis 17, what you're going to find out is that God appeared to Abraham about a year and a half, 2 years before he had his second son, okay? So Isaac is not the first son of Abraham. That's Ishmael. But when Abraham was like almost 100 years old, in Genesis 16, I think, God appeared to him and said, I'm going to give you a son. And Abraham said, you know, I'm too old. What am I going to do? So anyways, he says, no, I'm going to give you a son through your wife, Sarah. Sarah heard it and she laughed. She's like, yeah, right. I'm old. I can't conceive a baby. And if I conceived a baby, wouldn't be able to nurse a baby. My body's done. And so anyways, what we find out is that when about a year before Isaac was born, God gave to Abraham the covenant of circumcision. Okay, and so let me just read a little bit, because this covenant, okay, came before anything else. Sorry, I didn't have it looked up. I got to look it up. I got to type it, so it's not like I can turn pages. Technology's easier. That's what they say, right? Yeah. Not when it comes to this. So when Abraham was 99 years old, the Lord appeared to Abram and said to him, I am Almighty God, walk before me and be blameless, and I will make my covenant between me and you. Now, let me just stop there and say, the reason we're Christians today, the reason we have our faith today, is because God made a promise to Abraham, okay? That was God and Abraham. That had nothing to do with us. That had nothing to do with Moses. That had nothing to do with the law. This is a covenant that God made with Abraham. And everything that happens after Genesis 17 is all because of God's word to Abraham, not anything else. Okay? So 99 years old. He's an old guy, as you can figure that out. I will make my covenant between me and you, and I will multiply you exceedingly. Then Abram fell on his face, and God talked with him, saying, as for me, behold, my covenant is with you, and you shall be a father of many nations. No longer shall your name be called Abram, but your name shall be called Abraham, for I have made you a father of many nations. And I will make you exceedingly fruitful, and I will make a nation of you, and kings shall come from you. And I will establish my covenant between me and you and your descendants after you. And I will give to you and your descendants all the land in which you are a stranger, all the land of Canaan as an everlasting possession. I will be your God. So you get what's going on. So God says to Abram, I'm going to do this for you. And I'm going to give it to you and your descendants and everyone that comes after you. So Abram, this is the deal that you and I are making together. Now here is the actual deal that God makes with Abraham. Let's see, let me find it here. Okay, so, and God said to Abraham, as for you, you shall keep my covenant and your descendants and after you throughout their generations. This is my covenant which you shall keep between you and me and your descendants forever. Every male child among you shall be circumcised. And you shall be circumcised in the flesh of your foreskins. And it shall be a sign of a covenant between me and you. He who is 8 days old among you shall be circumcised. Every male child in your generations who is born in your house or bought with money from any foreigner who is not your descendant. He who is born in your house and he who is bought with your money must be circumcised. My covenant shall be, where's the covenant going to be? In your flesh. Now, it's an important thing to remember because flesh is critical to what we're doing in Ephesians, okay? So this covenant is going to be in your flesh. So my covenant will be in your flesh. I lost my place here. And the uncircumcised male child who is not circumcised in the flesh of his foreskin, that person shall be cut off from his people, for he has broken my covenant. Okay? And so then, verse 23, so Abram took Ishmael his son, and all who were born in his house, and all who were bought with money, every male among them of Abraham's house, and he circumcised the flesh of their foreskins the very same day as God had said to him. You talk about an uncomfortable afternoon at Abraham's house, right? I'm just saying, that would have been an uncomfortable afternoon for everybody involved. But that's what he did. So the covenant that God made with Abraham was circumcision. It was a symbol that was given in the flesh. Now, when we get into Ephesians, that's what Paul says separates Jews and Gentiles. So the Gentiles have been kept separate from the Jewish people for one reason. Now think about how crazy this would have been back in this day and age. There were Gentiles who had converted to Judaism. Okay? They had been baptized through some ritual. They voluntarily chose to follow the dietary guidelines. They voluntarily followed all of the law of Moses, and yet they were not allowed into the temple other than the court of the Gentiles. They did everything there was to do. The thing that kept them separate was an issue of the flesh. It was the issue of circumcision. And that issue is really what separated Jewish people from Christian people. And I would go on to say that it was that physical sign, it was that fleshly sign that the Jews clung to and said, you know what? Doesn't matter what anybody else says or does. We're the chosen people. We're the people that have the physical sign in our body that we are God's people. But here's the crazy thing. They trusted in the law to save them. And Paul does this beautifully in Galatians chapter 4:3, I believe. So Paul says that the law, which was introduced 430 years later, does not nullify the covenant that God made with Abraham. So if the law would have never come at all, okay, so let's just pretend for a minute that there was no Jewish law. That would not change anything in what God is doing in the world. It would not change anything in what God did with Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, or his people. Wouldn't have changed anything. The outcome would have still been the same. Jesus was coming to earth and he was going to die. The law really had little effect on that, except for one purpose, as Paul says. The law was our schoolmaster designed to bring us to Jesus. That's what it was for. And when you look at the law, it's hard to see. When you look at the law, what you should see is Jesus. Now, again, I know that's hard to do sometimes. That's just what the New Testament says. So when we get into this situation with the Gentiles. Because the Gentiles, no matter what they do, they are never going to be considered equal to the people of God. No one's going to look at them that way. Yeah, they got their part in the outer court, and that's as far as they're going to get. They're never going to get to be a part of the worship. They're never going to get to enjoy services in the temple like a full-blooded Jew would enjoy. Never going to be a part of that. So they're living at a distance from God, naturally. This is what Paul says about the condition they're in the next verse. And this is verse 12, I believe. That at that time you were without Christ. So, number one, they're without Christ. Number two, they're being aliens from the commonwealth of Israel. Number three, they're strangers from the covenant of promise. Number four, having no hope and without God in the world. So, four things these Gentiles are just separated from. They really don't know anything about Christ because they're not expecting a Messiah, don't need a Messiah. Doesn't matter what they do, doesn't matter how many customs they adhere to, they are never going to be a part of the nation of Israel. Never. They can go through the motions, but they're never going to be in. They're going to be alienated from God. Now, what he means by that, are strangers in the nation of Israel, alienated from God, doesn't mean that they can't know God, because we do know. God spoke to Gentiles. God used Gentiles all throughout the Bible. So it's not unique that God would do that. He's done that before. But here's what they're missing out on. When it came to, if there was a Gentile and they wanted to be very devout in their worship of Jehovah, the best it was ever going to be is watch from a distance. I mean, that was the best it was ever going to be. And I'm thinking at that point, why even go through all that stuff? Why put yourself through all the rituals just to always be on the outside looking in? Because that's where they were, just on the outside looking in. Until Jesus came and all that radically changed. Verse 13 says, but now, in Christ Jesus, you who were once afar off have been brought near by the blood of Christ. So, again, flesh is important in this. Blood is important in this. It was the blood of Christ that was shed on Calvary that paid for our sins. Jesus' blood was shed on our behalf. And that blood was the sacrificial offering that paid the price of God. And we're not going to talk about that again because we did that a few weeks ago. When we talked about what went on in the holy, in the most holy place, talked about how that blood, when God saw the blood, he looked over and forgave any sin. Jesus' blood was different in that when Jesus shed his blood on Calvary, God looked at the world and said, now you've got hope. Blood has been shed, and that blood can be yours. I almost said if the price is right, but that would have just been a bad analogy at that point, wasn't it? Wouldn't it? But that blood can be yours. You can claim the blood. And again, I don't want to go back to the Passover because we already did that. So it was through the shedding of Jesus' blood. And then he says in verse 14, for he himself is our peace, who is made both one. So the both that are made one are Jews and Gentiles. So God is our peace. And just in case you didn't know, Jewish people tended to be a little antagonistic and hostile towards non-Jewish people. And likewise, non-Jewish people tend to be a little antagonistic and hostile towards Jewish people. See that going on right now in our world. So it's nothing new. It's been there for a couple thousand years. What Paul says is that in Jesus, there are no more divisions of separation. There is no more Jew and Gentile. There is no more Greek and Jew. None of that exists anymore. Both have been made one. So both have been put together as one, and he has broken down the middle wall of separation, having abolished in his flesh. Again, we've got the word flesh. The enmity. So the word enmity shows up twice. That is a King James word for conflict or warfare would probably be a better way to say it. So when you see that word enmity, does anybody else have a different word in their translation? This is verse. Tyler, what do you got?
Hostility.
Hostility, that's a good word. So enmity, in my translation, means hostility or conflict or warfare or something like that. So what he says is that Jesus came down to break that middle wall of separation, and having abolished in his flesh the enmity, now notice what he says, the enmity that is in the law of the commandments. Because at this point, in this day and age, the law was division. It was separation. There were God-fearing, non-Jewish people wanting to get in, and they can't get in because the law stands as a barrier to keep them out. You can't get in because you don't eat the right food. You can't get in because you don't wear the right clothes. You can't get in because you hang out with the wrong people. You know, it's just amazing to me. The other thing I picked up in The Chosen, I don't know that anybody in any social class really likes anybody else, do they? This is what's weird, and I don't know if this is just unique to the movie or if this is unique in Jewish culture or American culture. Okay, so Simon in the movie, when we first meet Simon, I don't think anybody would say he's a righteous dude, would they? He's a drinker and a gambler and a fisherman. And if you know any fisherman, maybe except present company excluded, they tend to fall into that category in my experience. They can be gamblers and drinkers and fishermen, and I was in the Navy, so I would know that, okay? So that's the way Simon Peter is. I would not say at any point he's really devout. Even in season 3, I see Simon struggling with his faith big time. He hates Matthew, doesn't he? I mean, he despises Matthew. So here you've got a working class guy who's looking on another class saying he's the problem. But then the crazy thing is you've got the Pharisees who are up above everyone else, and they look at people and say, man, they're the problem. You had this whole nation of people pointing the finger at each other, saying everyone else is the problem. Imagine what happens when you inject a Gentile into that community. You got really big problems then. And so, look, if the Pharisee can't worship with the fisherman, and the fisherman can't worship with the tax collector, there ain't no way that a Gentile's showing up and getting involved in the game, because that ain't just going to happen. So the law was this dividing barrier that really kept, I'm going to say, by the time of Paul's writing, a big chunk of the church away from God. It's still a division. It's still a barrier because we're writing well after the death of Jesus. What, 20 years maybe, Tyler? Maybe more, Ephesians? 20, 30 years? So we're writing well into the early life of the church, and we've still got these issues where the Gentiles are kind of seen as second-class citizens all because of what's in their flesh. That's it. That's the only reason. There are some in the church that are circumcised. There are some that are not. And because of that, there's a group that says, yeah, you don't really fit in. Well, Paul says, that's not true. You all fit into this group because Jesus has made both of you one. Now, that would have been offensive, I think, to a lot of Jewish people. Probably kind of cool to the Gentiles who were looking to get in but can't. So Jesus made both one, and he has broken down the wall of separation and what he calls the law of commandments. And we can interpret that very simply as just the law that the Jews followed. So it's to create in himself, I love this, so it's to create in himself one new man. So it doesn't matter if you're Jew or Gentile. Let me just say this. It doesn't matter if you're Jew or Gentile. Doesn't matter where you're born or what you've done. Doesn't matter what your background is or where you come from. It doesn't matter what, you've done in your life. Doesn't matter what you've done. Because in Jesus, old things pass away, all things become new. We are new. Born again is the word we use. The Bible says that when we come to Jesus, old things pass away, all things become new. Everything becomes new. We are new. So Jesus does that through his physical body. And that's what Paul wants these Gentiles to understand. And that, verse 16, and that he might reconcile them both to God in one body, that's his body, through the cross, thereby putting to death the enmity or the hostility. So Jesus in one body. Now again, we're kind of transitioning here. So we're talking about this one body. So Jesus, in one body, through the cross, put together the hostility that existed between circumcised and uncircumcised, between Jew and Gentile, between everyone else and God. There was hostility between us, in case you didn't know that. The Bible says clearly that the fleshly mind, the worldly mind, the mind of the average person is in rebellion against God. Tyler's translation would probably say for the carnal mind is hostile towards God. My translation would say for the carnal mind is enmity against God, which means hostile towards God. That hostility that existed between us and God, or the world and God, Jesus broke down that enmity that existed, or that hostility that existed, through one body by dying on the cross. Jesus' death on the cross, man, I'm telling you, it broke every barrier that was ever erected. It broke down barriers between Jews and Gentiles. Now, they didn't get that real well in the early church. We still don't get that very well today. But that's what Jesus did. It broke down barriers between Christians and Rome. Who at that time, there was conflict between them. Or not now, but now, not at this immediate moment, but there will be very shortly, broke down those barriers. Jesus' physical body broke down every barrier that stood in the way. The biggest one was the barrier that separated us from him. Jesus broke down that barrier. He destroyed the sin that kept us alienated from God by doing one thing, by giving up his life on Calvary, by shedding his blood, by dying on a cross. Jesus paid that price. One of the things we get to do as a church is participate in the body and the blood of Jesus. And we do that through something called communion. So that's what we're going to do in just a little bit. We're going to participate in the body and blood of Jesus. And when we do that, I want you to remember, it doesn't matter where you've been or what you've done. It doesn't matter how you lived your life before you came to Jesus. It doesn't matter what you did last night. The Bible says if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us of our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Our participation in the body of Christ unites us to God in a way that is unique and different than anything else we do. Bow your heads as we pray.